division. The executive committee have already given their thanks, but we would like to just also give thanks to you publicly this morning. And we have one small gift that we would like to share with you. It is a light. It is symbolising the light of the world that your family will continue to give. And we also have some flowers. Because I believe this must be Bessie, because Bessie also has something to share. Thank you. Bessie was giving a gift there at the church. Bernie, thank you so much for all you have done and you have been and meant and still do for this association. May God bless you.
Employment. All, like many of us, have done something different.
different before he felt called to ministry. And when he started work at Southern Democracy, he occupied various positions as an intern, licensed minister, food coordination. He was fairly rapidly grabbed at a session to be the youth director of the Southern Conference. And at this point, I want to invite him to come and stand next to me. And Dawn, maybe you could raise us up here on the platform too, so that the whole congregation can see the two of them. So I advise that. Because these two stand. You can't hear me. Can you hear me at the back?
No. Go to the left.
If I use a lecture, you can. So you can now hear me.
Yes.
That's good, isn't it? Because all I could hear was echo. all right, so Paul and Dawn. If you see them standing before you. As I said, Paul has served in the Southern Conference as youth director until he was elected to be youth director at the BUC, where he variously also carried responsibilities for community services and APRA over time. Dawn joined him at the BUC, I think. Joined him at the BUC as a secretary, departmental secretary there. And she served as a departmental secretary right up until the end of June this year, when she had to leave us in order to be able to join Paul here in Scotland. I'm not sure yet. But Paul comes to you most recently from serving back in the Southingham Conference as the pastor of the Newbold College Church, where he went after he had served at the Trans-European Division for 10 years as youth director, and I believe also town ministries you carried for a while, yes. So Paul and Dawn, it's my pleasure on your behalf to welcome you to Scotland. I believe there are some little things to give you as well. Called to serve as president of the Welsh Mission.
until the union session in June of this year, when he was called to once again return to the British Union, this time to serve as Executive Secretary. And great joy of mine to be able to tell him all the things he's got to do. And he's learning well. So we welcome him to his service at the Union. And John, I should say, is married to Moira, who is a nurse and unable to be with us today, and he'll make sure she gets the flowers just like I do. Then we have Earl Ramrak Singh. Earl is not a pastor, but he can preach. Earl also did not start off in denomination employment. He worked in London in various accountancy positions and also as an auditor before accepting the invitation to join the Treasury team at the South England Conference, where he had Victor Pillmore as the Treasurer. And so they worked together then. Earl has since served as the Treasurer of the SEC since Victor took up the appointment as Union Treasurer in 2001, so Earl has served as the South England Conference Treasurer since that time until the Union session this year, when he was invited to take up the position of Union Treasurer, which he is still sort of just slotting into, because the South England Conference haven't yet replaced him. So he's a man with two hats, although one is more important than the other. And I won't tell you which. So Earl, who is married to Jackie, who is a teacher at Sunday Primary School, and he will make sure she gets the flowers on Sunday. And we welcome him also to the oversight of the financial affairs throughout the British Union. Thank you.
Thank you. read from one of my favourite translations, the Contemporary English Version of the UK. Matthew chapter 14, verse 22 to 33. Straightway, Jesus made his disciples get into a boat and start back across the lake. But he stayed until he had sent the crowds away. Then he went up on the mountain where he could be alone and pray. Later that evening, he was still there. By this time, the boat was a long way from the shore. It was going against the wind and was being tossed around by the waves. A little while before morning, Jesus came walking on the water towards his disciples. When they saw him, they thought he was a ghost. They were terrified and started screaming. At once, Jesus said to them, "Don't worry. I am Jesus. Don't be afraid." Peter replied, "Lord, if it is really you, tell me to come to you on the water." "Come on," Jesus said. Peter then got out of the boat and started walking on the water towards him. But when Peter saw how strong the wind was, he was afraid and started sinking. "Lord, save me," he shouted. Straightway, Jesus reached out his hand. He helped Peter up and said, "You don't have much faith. Why do you doubt?" And Jesus and Peter got into the boat. The wind died down. The men in the boat worshipped Jesus and said, "You really are the Son of God." May God have his blessing to this passage and to our reflection today. Steadfast God who takes us through the storms.
It's now time for us to seek God in prayer, so let us bow or kneel as appropriate as we pray together. Our Father in heaven, as we are gathered together in this place, we thank you for the warmth that we experience here. The warmth of physicality, fraternity, and spirituality. We thank you for the fellowship that we enjoy as people with a shared faith in you. Lord, we thank you for all the churches represented today from all over the Scottish Mission and further. We thank you that at times like this, we become aware that we are part of a bigger, wider movement. We thank you for the worldwide organization of the Seventh-day Adventist Church that enables us to have fellowship like this wherever we go in the world. For today, I'd like to particularly thank you for the work of the CREEF members, those who have built up relationships in this town over many, many years with the community, particularly with Christians of other faiths. We thank you for the relationship which has enabled us to use this building today. But Lord, whenever we're gathered like this, we are reminded of those who are absent. There are people missing today, Lord, either through ill health or through distance, or in some cases, through a fading of their faith. And Lord, we pray for each of those groups today. Use us, Lord, to help them in whatever way we can. And we think also, Lord, for the wider mission of this church, that of reaching out to those people in the communities where we live who have little or no faith. Lord, inspire us, give us wisdom as we take part in community activities that bring us into contact with these people. And now, Lord, we commit this service into your hands. We ask your blessing on the speaker. And we ask for perception as we listen to his words. And Lord, we ask for the grace of your Holy Spirit to go with us from this day, to take those words and nurture them in our lives and turn them into actions. This is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
So, thank you very much, the choir. Wow, that was something. And how many of you have noticed that what the choir was singing, what all of us were singing the 19th century hymns, are two very different words? Do you pay attention? And I can always remember what the choir was singing. And of course, not a shadow can rise, not a cloud in the sky. Can you sing it in brief? On 24th of September? Never fear. Really? I depend on my Petrovich Paolo in 1903, but I never cried. It is not that you want to go home. You are going to be afraid. But through it all, I made a decision. That's what we are going to talk about. So thank you very much for the invitation, and with all the thanks that were said today, maybe I should say thanks to Bob Lord, who invited me as an unknown professor at Google in 1999, when nobody knew me, and Ruth at Works invited me to an EC Pastors meeting, and that was my first encounter with the class the Bible weekend. And I have been in this video a few times, and the first time I was here was in 2005 when we ordained your pastor and preached myself. So glad to be back again. Open your Bibles to Matthew 14. And for your beautiful theme for this period, for this quinquennial 5 years, you have chosen the topic Steadfast Faith, Unswerving Hope, and Extravagant Love. And for this weekend, it's the Steadfast Faith. Yesterday night, we talked about the fact that what does it mean, Steadfast Faith? In the minds of most of us believers, Steadfast Faith means it's stable, it's not changing. And of course, that means that when the circumstances of life change, you pray to God to make sure your sailing is smooth. So that the circumstances don't change, they are only advantages to you, and then you can have steadfast faith. And we have learned yesterday night that you can't avoid disappointments in this world. That everybody goes through their share of disappointment. Even the Son of God in a situation that his Abba, Father, was not answering. And he died on the cross. Yet the author of Hebrews can say that his prayer was heard. His prayer was answered. And on the example of the disciples, we have learned that we can have steadfast faith because God is always willing to change our perception and interpretation of what is going on. And he opened their eyes to see things they did not see before. And suddenly what seemed as the greatest tragedy, the death of Jesus, they saw it through the scripture, through this meeting the stranger, through reflection on that, seeing that in the storyline of the Bible as the great event of salvation, of redemption. So, let's go to Matthew today and continue with what it means to have steadfast faith. Because if you are honest, you know that there are some clouds, there are some storms that come even to the lives of faithful believers. We don't have any 19th century writers for that. They did their best, but in 2016 we know better. Immediately, 14:22. Immediately Jesus made the disciples get into the boat. Have you noticed the language? Immediately after the story that parents so capably taught our children, immediately after feeding the 5,000, Jesus forced the disciples into the boat. understand what's going on here. After feeding 5,000, people got the message. And they have this idea that Jesus was making a wonderful king. Because he just gave them 5 pieces of bread and 2 fish, and he will feed how many? Yeah, it goes to 5,000 men. And if contemporary churches are anything to go by, you know that there are 5,000 men, there will be at least 10,000 women. And you know that where you have 5,000 men and 10,000 women, there will be at least 20,000 kids. So you are talking about a crowd of 35,000 people. And of course, we like to stay conservative when we are in the church. A lot of time we can be liberal, it's when the offering basket comes. So a very conservative estimate is this is a crowd of 30,000+ people. And people say, if Jesus can do this with 5 pieces of bread and 2 fish, imagine if you got him 1 sword, 1 chariot, and 1 horse. The Romans have no chance. Rome will fall down within a week. We need this guy to be on our side, to be our king. And so the people said, let's make him a king. And if you read the story in the Gospel of John, it's very clear there. But the response of Jesus was, no, no way. I won't do this. I am not that type of a king. I did not come to bring that type of kingdom. Now, here's the problem. The disciples thought that was a great idea. Because if Jesus is the king, they will have special positions in his kingdom. And so they want Jesus to become the king. And immediately after, Jesus forced the disciples into the boat and said, off you go to the other side. Get this, you are safer in a boat on the sea, within the will of God, than on the solid ground, with a crowd of people outside the will of God. The disciples want the crowd to crown Jesus as the king because the aftermath, the outcome for them. He said, no, no, I'm not into this business. Off you go. So they go in the boat. There is trust and obey. Okay? And they obeyed. They are off. Verse 23. After he dismissed them, went up on the mountainside by himself to pray. When the evening came, he was there alone. But the boat was already a considerable distance. Many stadia, it says, from the land, buffeted, tormented by the waves because the wind was against it. Now remember, when Jesus forced them into the boat, it's still the light. They go on this Sea of Gennesaret, which is not a very large body of water, about 4.5 miles wide, at the widest point. And here they are. Many hours later, and they still are somewhere in the middle of the sea. And you need to understand that many of these guys are professionals. They spend their whole lives in the boat. Verse 24. The boat was buffeted by the waves because the wind was against it. So, a storm comes along and it's so rough that they can't make it across this body of water. These professional sailors are unable to bring the boat to the other side. Verse 25. It tells us that Jesus comes. During the fourth watch of the night, Jesus went out to them walking on the lake. Now you need to know that Romans divided the night into 4 watches. So the sunset in Palestine is at 6 o'clock. So 6 to 9 was the first watch, 9 to 12 was the second watch, 12 to 3 was the third watch, and the fourth one was from 3 o'clock till 6.
So what are we talking about? At 3 a.m., Jesus, between 3, sometimes between 3 and 6, Jesus comes. They are still on the boat, still on the lake, that they left late afternoon. Try to picture in your mind the darkness, the storm, what it was like for them struggling to avoid being capsized. Now, I don't know much about boats. You understand, I come from Czechoslovakia, and that's a landlocked country. And I've been living in this country only for 17 years, and a diligent pastor does not know much about sailboats because you live in the pastoral salary. Understand that. But I imagine that getting out of the boat, I have been to Loch Ness, would be an intriguing enterprise when the sea was calm in the daylight. But imagine doing that in a storm at 3 o'clock in the morning. Imagine the gale force and the winds and the crashing waves. And Jesus says to them, "Be of good courage. It is me, it is I." And then he says something which, of course, in your Bible is translated, "Don't be afraid." But as I told you, I.P. Pavlov told us in 1903, you don't choose your emotions, emotions are always there. And so this time the Greek helps us. Jesus actually, in Greek, says, you do not need to continue being afraid. Because you can give a command in Greek language either by starting, by saying, don't start doing something, or don't continue doing something. And here Jesus says, don't continue. There is no need to continue being afraid. Okay, so Jesus doesn't say, guys, how come you experience fear? If you are going through a dark alley at night and a big dog jumps at you, what are you going to experience? Fear. Regardless of how much you believe or how much you love Jesus, you are going to experience fear because we don't choose our emotions. So if you experience loss, you are going to feel sadness. It's regardless whether your cat died or somebody scratched your new car or you used your wallet or your purse. You experience sadness if you go through loss. If you are blocked in reaching your goal, you experience anger. And if you feel threatened, you experience fear. But Jesus says, there is another way of responding to fear. You can respond in a different way than just screaming. And here comes, and notice Jesus immediately said to them, it will be very important because they won't immediately be repeated in the story later. But Peter responded, Lord, if it's you, tell me to come to you on the water. Whose idea was walking on the water? Peter's idea. It's not the first time or the last time that Peter speaks before he sings. Interestingly, if you turn one page in chapter 17, there is the story of the Mount of Transfiguration. And in verse 2 it says, the face of Jesus was shining like the sun, his clothes became white as the light, and three men appeared there. Moses and Elijah talking to Jesus. Two men appeared, three standing there with Jesus. And then it's very interesting, verse 4, and in Greek it says, answering Peter said. Interesting. Answering. Nobody's asking him any question. Yes, but answering, Peter said this. Lord, it's good for us to be here. If you wish, I will put up three tents, three shelters. And you know what was the response? Jesus said nothing. Actually, there was a voice coming from the cloud saying, listen to him. Don't listen to Peter. Listen to Jesus. Peter doesn't know what he's talking about. And one of the gospel writers said he didn't know what he was talking about. But this time,
Jesus, instead of saying, shut up, you are talking nonsense, Jesus says, come. Actually, it's a brilliant idea. Come. It's an experience that you are going to learn something from, as the choir song. Because when we speak about faith, we need to talk about the fact that faith, or trust, is intimately connected with risk. If you are taking no risk, you have no faith. No faith is with, there can be no faith without risk. And risk is always connected with fear. The problem is that in our mind, risk is connected with failure. And so here we go. Peter got down out of the boat, walked on the water, came forward to Jesus, but when he saw the wind, he was afraid, and he began to sing, cried out, Lord, save me. Imagine that. Peter gets out, and after walking, he fails. He doesn't make it. And so, we preachers will have to apologize to Peter and David, because their failures were a fertile soil for our sermons throughout the ages. How would you like to have preachers preaching sermons on your life failures? Did he fail? Was it a failure? Now it depends how you look at it. I want to do something that normally I don't do in the church, but if you allow me, I'm a visiting speaker, so I'm not here next week, so you can tolerate me a little bit. If you give me a little slack, I want you to do a mass confession. We are not good at confession in Seventh-day Adventist Church, because as the Remnant Church, we have the triumphant theology, so we are not very good at confessing. And so I want to ask you if you have ever failed in your life. And I'm going to give you some examples of some failures. And so that we make it anonymous, I will ask you to raise your hand at the end. So, if you can say with integrity and honesty and affirm the fact that in no point in your life you have failed a test, you have been ever dropped from a team, you did not get the job you wanted, or promotion that you was due to you, or that you have not been impatient with a three-year-old child, or that you have not eaten with the wrong fork or worn synthetic fibers, that you have never experienced the moral, athletic, academic, social, financial, vocational, relational, or spiritual failure, now is the time to raise your hand. Really. So let's do it the other way around. If you have ever experienced any of these failures in your life, can you raise your hand? Right now, have a look around and say to the person next to you, welcome to the club. You see, we have all failed personally at some point of our lives. The problem is that if you look at the failure as something disastrous, life becomes about failure avoidance. Benjamin Zander, the conductor of Boston Philharmonic Orchestra, is working with the top musicians in the world who have the potential to make a great contribution to the music. And he knows one thing. If you are afraid of failure, you are not going to perform at the top of your capacity. And so he teaches his musicians, when you perform that, the peace, and you make a mistake. And I know what I'm
talking about? I'm a son of a pastor, and my father knew that if you know in Adventist church how to play the piano, your market value goes up. You get a better wife if you know how to play the piano. So as a little boy, I had to learn how to play the piano. For 4 years, I have struggled, and my teachers struggled, teaching me how to play the piano. So I have learned this thing. The moment you start thinking, and where does this finger go, that's the end of the concert. You have the concert as long as you can play and not think about the fingers. So Benjamin Zander says, when you make a mistake, you just raise your hand and say, fascinating. I was thinking how the Church of God would look differently if we could say with Benjamin Zander, fascinating. If we could say with Jesus, who said to Peter, instead of Peter, I haven't heard such a stupid idea. Master, like the disciple. Come. You see, there is something inside the human being that tells us that life must be more than just failure and avoidance. That God did not intend the human life of beings created in the divine image to be just failure and avoidance. God did not create you simply to go through life in a desperate attempt to avoid failure. Because the moment you start thinking, I might think, it might not work out well, you change the perspective. And it's the fear that determines the outcome of your action. And so, let me tell you, if you allow your emotions, whether it's fear or loss or anger, to dictate the decisions you make, you are going to be the victim of circumstances. You are never going to have a steadfast faith. Your faith is going to depend on your circumstances, and then your prayer is going to be, Lord, make sure everything works out. Make sure that nothing bad happens. Make sure that the circumstances are advantageous to me. Now tell me, in a fallen world, can the circumstances always work out in your favor? In your life, does it work out? So Peter says, Lord, if it's really you, command me. You tell me, and if you tell me, I can do it. He sees the command of the Lord. Then he obeys. Jesus says, all right, Peter, get out of the boat. And for the first time in history of human race, an ordinary mortal person is walking for a few moments, just Peter and Jesus. So here's the question, did Peter fail? It depends how you define failure. So here's the thing to remember. Failure is not an event. Failure is an interpretation of an event. Failure is the label you put to the event. Jonas Salk was the one scientist who invented the vaccination for polio. He attempted 200 times unsuccessfully to come up with a vaccination that worked. And so sometimes somebody asked him, how did it feel to fail 200 times trying to invent a vaccination for polio? This is what Jonas answered. I never failed 200 times at anything in my life. I simply discovered 200 ways how not to make a vaccination for polio. Somebody asked Winston Churchill, what prepared you the best to lead Great Britain during the World War II? For a period when Britain had to stand virtually alone against Nazi Germany. And Churchill's response was, it was the time when I had to repeat a class at school.
The Christian said, "You mean you flunked a class?" Churchill said, "I never flunked anything in my life. I just was given a second opportunity to get it right." Failure is not an event. It's an interpretation you put to an event. It's a label you put to it. Did Peter fail? Maybe, yeah, his faith gave way. He didn't stay locked looking at Jesus, he sank. Let me tell you, there were 11 bigger failures than Peter. They failed privately, quietly, safely, unnoticed and criticized in the boat. Peter experienced the shame of public failure, but only Peter experienced the joy of walking on the water, and only Peter knew, verse 31, immediately Jesus reached out his hand and caught him and said, once again in your translation it says, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" Now, you can read the Greek text according to N.T. Wright, a professor at Scottish University. "You had fine faith. Was there a need to doubt? You already had little faith. There was no need to doubt. That was an opportunity for the little faith to grow in." You see, sinking people need to know that Jesus is fully adequate to save. And he's adequate to save not only the bride, but also the bridegroom, coming back to our youth skit. Peter had this shared moment of a connection with Jesus that nobody in the boat ever had, because they stayed there. So, you know what happened to those people? They also failed, but their failure was much worse, because they felt safe in their failure, and that's why they didn't learn anything. They considered themselves better than Peter, and that's why it was such a dangerous thing. So, Jesus is still looking for people are willing to get to the situation and see the potential where other people don't see it, to change the perspective. Of course, he does not look us for high risk-taking, adrenaline, extreme sports addicts. There is no glory in risking for the risk's sake. That's not the nature of discipleship.
Make sure you don't spoil the kingdom for me.
teaching them it's okay to get out of the boat. He prepared his leaders, his followers. It's okay to fail, as long as you learn something from it. Because a failure is not an event, it's an interpretation. Most of us want to have a comfortable life. I was watching some advertisement that came during the program, and I noticed that the chair that was on sale was called a lazy chair. We just want to vegetate in front of the TV set. And you know how you call these people? Who try to vegetate in front of the TV set? You call them couch potato. So let me tell you, 11 disciples were boat potatoes. And the contemporary church holds as its idea pew potatoes who pray, Lord, just make me comfortable. Don't ask anything from me that brings fear or sadness into my life. Let me tell you, Jesus is still looking for disciples like Peter. Not for pew potatoes, but those who are willing to get out of the boat, step into unknown, try and try, walk the path they have not tried before. I don't know what it looks like in your life. Maybe you are married and Christ is tugging at you, that your spouse has not been particularly interested in spiritual growth, and you are waiting for the spouse to move. And Jesus is saying to you, oh, leave it in my hands. I am working on her, on him. I want you to imagine. Maybe it's an opportunity to make a career change, to move up the ladder, make a greater impact for Christ and his kingdom. Maybe it's a calling to sacrificial generosity. Maybe it's a calling to do something you have not tried before. If you are honest with your God, you will know what it is. So often, when I look into my heart, with the need to appear successful, to impress other bold potatoes with my success, I have it together. But Jesus is not into this business. Jesus says, come, you can do it. There is no such failure that can place you beyond my loving care, beyond the care of Jesus. Immediately, Jesus reached out his hand and caught him. You had fine faith, there was no need to doubt. Immediately, he had new tech experience. Failures don't mean the end of God's relationship with us. His love is unchanging, unfailing, unconditional, agape love that does not change based on our performance. So, you know what was the outcome? Because Peter dared out to get out of the boat, the last text says that those who were in the boat worshipped him, saying, truly, you are the Son of God. Because of this new encounter, new experience, Peter got a new perception of who Christ is, and other people got a new perception of who Jesus is. The power of Jesus to save even those who fail. If you and I are looking for steadfast faith and are willing to make daring steps here in Scotland, in your community life as a church, in your personal life, other people will see Jesus in a new life. They will be worshipping him and saying, it's not because of her, it's not because of him, because that success came because of power of Christ. He is mighty to save. So, there is no faith without risk. There is no risk without fear. But it's not the emotion that decides what we are going to do. It's the steadfast faith that must determine our response. And if we trust, in a way, in spite of our fears, Jesus will be there. He will pick you up if you fall, but you will be closer to Him, and other people will see Him as the Son of God and worship Him because of what He did in your life, but we have not been accomplished.
People willing to do your will, the capacity